Hello and welcome. Foreign policy has been one of Prime Minister Modi's top priorities in his 3 years in office, and this is appropriate given the political and economic volatility in international affairs. As a large country with a fast-growing economy, the world's second largest army, nuclear weapons and long-range missiles, the idea of India in 2017 is that India has no choice but to be a major force in international affairs. Prime Minister Modi came into office unencumbered by the burden of either the Nehruvian foreign policy that had guided India for half a century or Dr. Manmohan Singh's somewhat modified version of it, which was in place for the previous decade. As Prime Minister Modi returns home after a historic visit to Israel and attending the G20 summit in Hamburg, 3 years into office, the Modi government faces a changed geopolitical terrain marked by the election of Donald Trump as the U.S. president. We now have an unpredictable United States, an aggressive China. Meanwhile, the India-China standoff at the Northern Trijunction in Doklam bordering Bhutan has brought divisions of the armies of both countries face to face. In this program, we're going to be looking at the strategic shifts in India's foreign policy under Prime Minister Narendra Modi's leadership, the opportunities they present and the risks they pose. Joining us on the show, former Foreign Affairs Minister Salman Khurshid, former diplomat and author Pawan Varma. He's been India's envoy to Bhutan and Cyprus. He is the General Secretary of the JDU, Dr. Shilkan Sharma. From 2008 till 2011, he was the former Secretary General of SAARC. He's also the former permanent representative of India to the UN in Vienna and the IAEA. Jyoti Malhotra, senior journalist specializing in foreign policy. Justin Rowlett, South Asia correspondent of the BBC. We have Bharat Karnad, professor of National Security Studies, Center for Policy Research, and the author most recently of Why India is Not a Great Power Yet. And Dhruv Jaishankar, fellow for foreign policy at the Brookings Institution India Center in New Delhi. I want to start with some opening comments from our panelists. Let's go across to Salman Khurshid first. Mr. Khurshid, the Prime Minister has visited over 60 countries since 2014. In terms of foreign policy achievements, where does India stand today, 3 years into this government's tenure? Because the headline images of this week have been two, one positive, one negative. First, of course, the Indian Prime Minister in Israel, and the latter being Indian and Chinese forces face-to-face in Doklam.
Well, clearly, that's a lot of energy, frankly. One must grant that to the Prime Minister. It's an enormous amount of energy. But this kind of solo flights that he's making, it seems that the rest of his government is not seemingly involved as generally in such matters governments are involved. But be that as it may, it's his style and it's his government, and he has a mandate to work in the manner that he pleases. But given that so much energy has been pumped into foreign policy, I don't see major achievements that we can write home about. I think that you've just mentioned things about the U.S., about China, things about our neighborhood. We could even look at our inability to carry matters in the manner that we would want to in many parts of the world, simply because despite having all the prowess that you've mentioned, it doesn't translate into acceptable articulation in the world. And I'm not quite sure that in our foreign policy we understand anything that the world wants to do. We certainly know very well what we require and what we want to do, but are we willing to spend a little time on what the world wants, right or wrong from our point of view, so that we can approach it in a manner that is meaningful and effective?
All right. Mr. Karnad, you heard Mr. Khurshid over there. He's saying this is about optics, there's showmanship perhaps, but there's no real substance.
Yeah, that's precisely what's wrong with the Indian foreign policy, what he said. The fact is we should not do or try to do whatever it is the world wants. We have to pursue our own interests. You see, we try to cater to all kinds of interests all over the place and try to be nice and be seen as nice and responsible and so on and so forth. In the bargain, your national interests are invariably hostage to other people's expectations. That's been the main problem. The other thing is, I don't think we quite understand, MEA understands, or the MOD, or the government for that matter, understands hard power. There's no appreciation of hard power. The capabilities we have are inappropriate for great power. that we seek in theory, and we somehow expect that being whale-sized is enough to get you great power status.
Are you talking about economically?
You are a trillion-dollar economy, but as I said, you are whale-sized with the impact of a minnow. Minnow is a small fish. You haven't had the right policies throughout. You've just had reform since 1992, and then you haven't really progressed fast enough. The administrative system is what it is, full of shackles and barriers and red tape. It's still all there. The ease of doing business, I think we are still way down in the list. So, I mean, then we expect the world to invest here, and our prime minister goes to all over the globe trying to attract monies for investment. Nobody's going to invest if the milieu is not conducive. Licenses take forever. There's still the license raj. So how do we expect to get from here to there without doing all the things to get from here to there?
So is this government any different from the previous government?
No, it's not. I mean, this is the great disappointment, I think, because Mr. Modi promised a lot. He did, with his various slogans, not least of which was
minimum government, maximum governance.
So these are the sorts of things. I think in foreign policy, he has pretty much followed the line that the previous governments had, laid down. True, he's a far greater backslapper and hugger and embracer of foreign leaders than our previous prime ministers. And that's, of course, awkward for many Western leaders who, naturally feel a bit discomfited. But that said, I think he had Trump on the back foot, actually, with the embrace, even though Trump was told that this is what you should expect. So this is a wonderful thing that he imposed himself physically on Trump, who's about 6 feet three or whatever, but our prime minister is 56 inches chested, so I think that won over. But it's a wonderful thing, though. But a point to make really is this. Substantively, again, in the United States, did we get what we want? I think Trump got most of the substantive issues that he wanted to push. We didn't. We got the embrace and the hug.
Dr. Sharma, then, will you respond to that? What did India get from the visit to the United States, apart from the optics of the hugs and the big event, like we've had Madison Square Garden in the past, all of that, that makes for great show, but what does India get away?
The MSG show was 3 years back.
Of course.
And the present visit. Now, at that time when Prime Minister Modi went, he was a new leader of our country with a vast, massive majority behind him. And he led the diaspora identify with him. So that time, when he captured the imagination of the people in New York or wherever he went in the US and subsequently, that was a phenomenon, because these people who had gone to America, they had stood in queues overnight for long years, for visas, and they had reached there, built themselves up from their own bootstraps. And here was a prime minister who went straight to them, identified with them. He told them that I have visited America like you, and I have traveled here for 6 months like you do. So there was an instant identification. So that resonance in MSG was different. Today, Trump has given a different message. But the achievement of this present visit was that all the apprehensions and the uncertainties about Trump's approach to India, they were, to a large extent, put to rest. There were a lot of stories that the Pakistanis are again worming their way into it, and they might get into the Trump, bandwagon, and they might start talking like, if you remember 2009 when Obama had come, he had started talking about AFPAC, and this fellow Richard Holbrooke came to South Asia trying to give a new, dimension. But we resisted that at that time. Similar fears were again on the horizon. But Prime Minister Modi's visit was successful in that sense that the fears were put to rest.
Jyoti, is that the message we got from the visit with President Trump? Because, correct me if I'm wrong, on the campaign trail, it seemed like President Trump was on a collision course, or to be president was on a collision course with China. But that seems to have changed. We've had the Mar-a-Lago summit with President Xi. Trump seems to have agreed that the U.S. needs China for various reasons, whether it's to counter North Korea, whether it's for its own economic health, whether it's the Trump family's own personal investments in China. So is that really the message that we got from that visit?
I think, Sarah, that you have to admire Prime Minister Modi's ambition. There's no question about that, and his energy and his drive. And when he goes to the U.S., or when he went to the U.S. recently, as you saw, the Indian side deliberately sort of underplayed the visit, because Trump is an unpredictable sort of chap.
Correct.
And you don't know what you can expect from him. But from all accounts, it seems to have gone off very well, public as well as sort of people who speak off the record. But I'm just wondering, so here, yes, and he's he's the Hamburg visit or the G20 visit, where he sort of met Xi Jinping for a few minutes. I think, and you also spoke in your introduction about the face-off in Doklam. Now, what has been interesting in the last few months is that the Prime Minister has clearly brought down the rhetoric on China, and you saw that in Astana at the margins of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, which is very different from a year ago when he asks Xi Jinping for India's membership into the NSG. Now, so in a sense, I think right now the face-off at the Doklam in the Himalayas is, we don't know what's really happened, but the fact is that the Indian Prime Minister is not backing down. So I think that's also interesting. The other point that I'd like to make is, later on this year, there will be the SAARC summit, which was canceled last year, you remember, Sarah, not only by India, but there were four countries in the region that told Pakistan that we are not coming to the summit. So the summit was off. That question will come up again in front of the Prime Minister. What is India going to do? Are you going to say, we are not going to Pakistan again? So the point that I'm trying to make is, what does India do with the region? You can make friends with Donald Trump. Of course, you have to make friends with Donald Trump. He is a very, very powerful leader. You are telling the Chinese that we are the other Asian power that you cannot ignore, and you can be as aggressive as you want in the Himalayas and the South China Sea or elsewhere, with the Chinese, the party Congress coming up. But what does India do with its region? And it's not only about Pakistan. I just want to point out also that...
So you're saying the neighborhood first policy, the basic pillar of one of their foreign policies, not work.
In the Maldives, for example, earlier in July, the opposition, 45 MPs, a four-party coalition, came together and are now in a majority. But India continues to support the ruling party, the ruling government in power. That is going to be very embarrassing for India if this opposition coalition impeaches the speaker. So I'm not sure that India has its eye on the ball in the Indian Ocean region, in the Maldives especially. So I think you have to look at your own region first and see what's going on in the region. And you must make friends, of course, with the rest of the world. But let's not forget what's happening in South Asia.
Mr. Varma, Jyoti says that India is not backing down when it comes to China. You've been envoy to Bhutan. While she says the Prime Minister is not backing down, we've heard some very strident comments coming in from the Chinese side. And opposed to that, on the contrary, we're seeing this deafening silence coming in on the Indian side. You think that's a strategic decision?
India is not backing down as of now, but India's track record in dealing with an aggressive China has not been very impressive. And I would say that when China, for instance, ordained that people from Arunachal Pradesh will get stapled visas, I would think any self-respecting country would say that in that case, Chinese of Tibetan origin would get stapled visas. When China prevents us from looking for oil in South China Sea or makes the task difficult, I think we should have been asking the question over years, why China has invested billions in POK, Pak Occupied Kashmir. It's declared an internationally disputed area, while the South China Sea is not. So whether it's on these issues or other matters, China has blocked our membership of the NSG. China has refused to give Azhar the tag that the UN wants to give him. So I think that the time has come for India to understand, and particularly where Doklam is concerned. I have some other general comments on foreign policy as such. But since you asked me in the specific context of the face-off now between India, China, where Bhutan is involved in the very strategically important area of the Doklam plateau, I am saying to you categorically that if India doesn't stand by Bhutan here, and if indeed India doesn't stand for its own strategic interests here, we will be making a big mistake. And it's time to tell China that aggressive, intimidatory language used repeatedly will not necessarily make for a weak-kneed India, but we also have a prime minister who in his eloquence is often muscular, but in his actions is less so. We saw it with Pakistan, where his speeches in 2014 were that he would put Pakistan in its place immediately. How much he has succeeded in doing so, we have seen now, notwithstanding the surgical strike. And there has been an incoherence as far as policy in the neighborhood is concerned, which needs rectification with Pakistan, with China. An example was mentioned by Jyoti of Maldives. I think that we need to focus on our own areas. There have been some pluses, certainly, with other countries. Because, you know, foreign policy is a continuum. It represents a national consensus. It's not as if the BJP will come to power, wave a magic wand and completely change the contours that should define your foreign policy. But in general, I will say that in foreign policy, you do not go by the optics, but by the outcomes. And here he seems to have made a great impact on the Indian diaspora. But we are still assessing the outcomes.